Well, greetings in Jesus' name. I'm Norm Rasmussen, and I feel the Lord would have me read something, a precious writing written by Rick Segoine. So in obedience, I'm going to do that. Now, this article I have taken from the ministry website of raptureready.com, and I'm not going to read the entire writing. I'm only going to read some of it, but I will provide a link down in the description section where people can click on that link and read the entire writing if they want. So, but I just feel that God wanted this put on video because there's many people who may not see it in text, but if it's on video, perhaps they would find it. But we leave that up to the Lord. The title here is, Who is Jesus Christ Really? Who is Jesus really? My heart is that, well, my suggestion maybe would be a better way is for people who aren't sure what they believe about Jesus Christ and what they believe about the Bible, make it two prayers. One is asking God to reveal to you, if that's you, who Jesus Christ really is, and can the Holy Bible be trusted? The Old Testament and the New Testament Bible. Can it be trusted? Who is Jesus, and can the Bible be trusted? Because everything we know about Jesus is recorded in the Bible. And if people can't trust what's written in the Bible, then they aren't where God really wants them to get to, okay? You've got to be able to trust the Bible. You've got to. So it's up to God to quicken the validity of God's Word, the Holy Bible, to each and every one of us. Some people get it early. They don't question that it's trustworthy. People like me, I had to go through a lot of spiritual surgery before I could believe the Bible could be trusted. And on the same day, that took about 7 hours many years back, where God took me aside and not only revealed to me that the Bible could be trusted, but he also revealed to me who Jesus Christ really was. So he did both in one day, in about a 7 hour time frame. He has many ways to go about doing that. But had he not done that, I would not be a follower of Jesus, most likely, and I certainly wouldn't be quoting the Word of God. So with that, let's now move on to his writing, Rick's precious writing. Jesus spoke the first word, and he will have the last word in regard to the destiny of his creation and all that is in his creation. Let's have a little warm substance here to calm the throat. Quote, I'm quoting from John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The creation itself in part or in full, is not greater than nor stronger than he who did the creating. That is a powerful statement. Let me read it again. The creation itself, in part or in full, is not greater than nor stronger than he who did the creating. There is no created being, angelic or human or creature of any kind, that is greater than or stronger than he who created all living beings. The supernatural power and strength of the living God are far beyond the comprehension of mortals and angels alike. This Jesus, he's the Alpha and the Omega. Revelation 1:8 decrees that. He declares the end from the beginning, as Isaiah 46:10 states, and everything between the end and the beginning. I'll say that again. He declares the end from the beginning and everything between the end and the beginning. He foresaw it all, even before the foundation of the world was set and spoken by him into existence. He even knew all about the life of every person ever born. And he knew before they even became a seed planted in their mother's womb. And his hand was there to form each of us in the womb. That's a quote found in Psalm 139, verse 16. Or a proof text of what that statement just said. God knew that Adam and Eve would disobey him in the Garden of Eden, and that it would cause the fall of humankind into sin. Because of this, the Lamb of God was declared before the foundation of the world, that being Jesus, being the Lamb of God. Scripture text, 1 Peter 1, verse 19 through 20. Again, I'm giving you scripture texts because any good communicator of spiritual truth backs it up with Bible passages that clearly support the statement made. And so that's what Rick is doing here, in case you're wondering why I'm reading off some scripture texts. Okay, God is omniscient, omnipresent, and omnipotent. 1 John 3:20, Jeremiah 23:24, 1 Kings 8:27, Psalms 92, Job 42:2, Luke 1:37. God is the Alpha and Omega. He's the Word that became flesh, John 1:14. Here's a profound statement. Listen up. The Father knew that he would need to send his Son, the second person in the Holy Trinity, on a rescue mission of mercy to be the sacrificial lamb who, being without sin, could and would take all of the sins of mankind and womankind upon himself in order to provide redemption for all who had sinned, which was everyone. Romans chapter 3, verses 9 through 26. Everyone, that is, except God's only begotten Son, Jesus became the only one who ever lived inside a human body that never sinned. He's the only one qualified to even be the sacrificial lamb. Hebrews 4:15. Let me do a little insert here for those of you who are very uninformed. When we talk about the Lamb of God, the Old Testament talks about the way that God provided for the Jewish people to have their sins not forgiven, but for God to have extended mercy toward them until Jesus Christ came upon the scene in the future. And so what they were to do was to take a spotless lamb, the best of the best, and slay that lamb and shed the blood upon the mercy seat. And there was a whole lot to be said, but it was the sacrifice of an innocent animal, an innocent little lamb, that God said that they were to do to cover his anger and wrath toward the sins that they had committed prior to that. Okay, I won't say any more because I don't want to disrupt the flow here. Jesus accomplished this sacrifice on the cross at Calvary. In other words, he was the perfect, sinless, innocent, quote, lamb. Though it wasn't a lamb. It was God himself. Okay, Jesus accomplished this sacrifice on the cross at Calvary. The main thing required of each fallen sinner was, and still is, belief. A quote from John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." Belief leads to faith, and faith leads to trust. Complete 100% belief, faith, and trust. Unwavering and absolute faith that Jesus is who he himself says he is, as well as who his Father says he is, and who the Holy Spirit and all of his disciples, apostles, and the prophets say he is. And just who is it that he and they say he is? He is quoted as saying in John 14:6, "I'm the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me." Matthew chapter 3, verse 17 is a quote from God the Father speaking down out of heaven, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." And then in Matthew 16:16, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Then in Acts chapter 4, verse 12, "There's no other name under heaven by which one can be saved." Let me qualify that. Saved from what? Saved to have their sins forgiven so they can get to heaven when they die. It means to be saved. Saved from the penalty of our sins. "All who call on the name of Jesus shall be saved." Romans 10:13. "By his stripes we're healed." Isaiah 53:5. I'm just going to do a little norm insert here. There are elements in the body of Christ who want to try to tell us that that is the a promise that God will heal us physically whenever we need physical healing. I don't believe that. I do not believe that. What God is saying, it was by the punishment inflicted upon him, he paid the price, painfully paid the price. He took the punishment for all of our sins, past, present, and future, so that we might be healed spiritually with God. That's what the Holy Spirit wants us to understand about that. Okay. To believe in Jesus is to be saved. Salvation freely belongs to all who believe. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, it reveals that salvation and eternal life are the gift of God the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. If God says that, quote, belief, unquote, is our boarding pass to heaven, if God says that belief is our boarding pass to the heaven-bound train, then it is true because God is holy and he cannot and does not lie. Not once, not ever. The saved thief on the cross next to Jesus, who had no time to do anything other than believe, is an eternal witness to believing being the key to salvation. Luke 23:43 supports that. Belief in him, or Jesus, who declares the end from the beginning. Belief in him who is the Alpha and the Omega. Belief in the great, quote, I am, who is eternal God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Exodus 3:1-22 and John 8:48-59. Belief in him, or belief in Jesus Christ, who loves you so much that he was willing to lay down his life for you, willing to die in place of you. Belief in him who rose from death and conquered it so that you may live, and so I may live, and so all who believe on the name of Jesus may not only live, but live forever in resurrected bodies similar to his. Bodies that do not get sick. Bodies that will never grow old or wear out and die. Bodies that will not be tempted by sin, corruption, or wickedness of any kind at all. And that's backed up by 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 57. I'll just do a little norm insert. That is the promise for every true born-again Christian. We're all going to get resurrected bodies. And these bodies, we don't know a whole lot about. We heard a little bit here about what they are, but they're going to be glorified bodies that God determined we need, and whatever God determines we need is good for us. Okay, now moving on. He who is the Alpha and the Omega foresaw all that has happened, all that is happening now, and all that has yet to happen. Everything that is happening right now at this very moment in time. Everything happening all over this entire planet as we travel along the prophetic timeline, he foresaw. He has revealed through Holy Scripture his plan for the future for all who believe and trust in him. He has revealed his plan for those who reject him and hate him. The ones that call evil good and good evil. Isaiah 5:20 is a reference for that. He has not kept these things a secret. Whosoever reads the Word of God or the Holy Bible from beginning to end will discover how creation began and how the phenomenon of time became a temporary yet vital part of God's plan. Whoever reads the Word of God from beginning to end will also discover God's plan of how creation, as we know it, will play out and how time will eventually merge back into the timeless state that preceded creation as we know it. Well, there's much more to that writing, and again, I provided the link to the entirety of it in the description section below for those who might want to read it. It talks about the future, of what's going to happen, as much as God wants us to know about that. And so it's very, very hopeful in what's coming down for those who have put their trust in Jesus Christ as personal Lord and Savior. So I do pray that as God might will, He will use this to touch somebody, help them along their journey to connecting with God in alignment with truth, and then growing in their appreciation for what God gave humanity. He gave humanity the greatest gift that He could have given humanity, and that was the sacrifice of Himself, so that we each can get to heaven when we die. We each get this glorified body that will have unlimited, unimaginable potential. I personally believe that the Holy Spirit has revealed to me a small portion of truth about this resurrected body that we'll all get one day. The joy that God is going to give us. We need a different container to contain it all and to appreciate it more. And I believe that glorified body is actually going to enable us to receive dimensions of joy that we simply cannot fathom now. These glorified bodies will enable us to bring a never-ending increase of glory to God. Never-ending. So, my friend, yet my call is to try to reach out to those mostly who aren't sure what they believe about God. What should they believe about God? And I just pray that somebody might have received something from the Holy Spirit on this broadcast to help them in their journey connecting with God and being fruitful for God. Making life count for God. So thanks for hearing me out, and may God richly bless you.